wounded, battered and abused, but the Lord saves, so come ready to be used. He was beaten and bruised for the remission of your sins, so come as you are and let new life begin.
Well, Pastor Wesley is the truth, he spits the gospel fire, so come praise the Lord, grow your faith, welcome to CAYA.
Remission of your sins, so come as you are and let new life begin.
Well, Pastor Wesley is the truth, he spits the gospel fire, so come praise the Lord, grow your faith, welcome to CAYA.
Remission of your sins, so come as you are and let new life begin.
Well, Pastor Wesley is the truth, he spits the gospel fire, so come praise the Lord, grow your faith, welcome to CAYA.
Oh, come, come as come ready to be used. He was beaten and bruised for the remission of your sins. So come as you are and let new life begin.
Well, Pastor Wesley is the truth. He spits the gospel fire. So come, praise the Lord, grow your faith. Welcome to CAYA.
What is up, you guys, and happy Wednesday. My name is Coco, and welcome to Pregame with Coco. I'm so excited to be here with you all in fellowship in the house of the Lord, y'all. But today, I have a special guest here with me, so please help me welcome Reverend Ty.
What's up, family? Hey. How are y'all? I'm so excited. This is our first time doing this, man.
This is our first time doing this.
And I get our star of the hour, Coco. So happy to see y'all. Thank y'all.
Okay, so Ty, can you tell me a little bit about what we can expect in today's lesson, Father's Day?
So, essentially, we did this thing, like, everybody saw Kirk Franklin's documentary.
Mm-hmm.
The CD comes out on Friday.
Mm-hmm.
But, man, I watched it, and I was like, this would be a good conversation.
Okay.
And I know a lot of people are dealing with various things around fatherhood, being a man, and the implications of such. So, I was like, I pivoted. We were supposed to do something different. But after I saw that, I was like, this is what we want to do today.
Absolutely. So, yeah. Okay, so since we're going to get into the lesson a little later, I think we should have some fun.
Let's have it.
Okay.
Let's do it.
Okay. So we have a few guests here with us today.
We got some guests.
We're going to play some games. Oh. We're going to do some interviews.
What?
And then we're going to get this show on the road, okay?
What?
I'm going to let Ty take over today.
So our first guest coming up now is Lexi. Lexi, come on right here. Right here. What is your name?
Lexi Burns.
Now, Lexi, is this your first CAYA?
Yes.
Thank you so much. This is Lexi's first CAYA, and we drafted her to be a part of the pregame. She did not know what was going on, so thank you so much for coming to be a part. Where are you from?
I'm from Minnesota.
Okay.
Yep,
okay.
Minneapolis.
And how did you end up in the DMV?
So I have a remote job, love DC, always wanted to live here, and now I made it happen.
We're so happy to have you here tonight. Thank you for coming. Well, guess what? We want to have a little fun here tonight, okay? Let's jump right into a game. Are you willing? You ready to play?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Come on.
Okay. Here I am. Okay. So this game is called Finish the Lyric, okay?
Don't get nervous.
Okay.
It's all the songs are going to be Kirk Franklin songs.
The whole world's
that's
watching.
A little hint for you, okay? So this is, here we go. This is the first lyric. The angels bow down at the thought of you.
Come on, Lex. Come on. It's 500 people watching. Come on.
I don't got it.
Okay, oh. Do you at least know the song? Lexi. Y'all listen to Kirk Franklin in Minnesota?
I do. But I just don't know this one.
Okay.
I don't really know like every word.
Okay. Let's try another one. Yes, Jesus loves me.
The Bible tells me.
Yes.
So.
There you go.
Yes.
Woo. I was worried.
All right, Lexi.
I didn't know what was going to happen.
All right, Lexi. Okay, can you tell me what your favorite Kirk Franklin song is? If you have one.
Ooh. Yes. Trying to come up with the title.
Can you hum it?
You want to sing for the people?
I should have done my research before coming. Okay.
That's okay. You know what, Lexi? I want you to just enjoy your evening here tonight. We thank you for coming and joining us. We thank you for partying with us. And happy CAYA.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Lexi.
Thank you.
We really appreciate it. Thank you. We got another guest.
We do.
And guess what? I think this is our first time as well.
Really?
Yes. So
okay.
Our second guest is on her way, Bree.
Hi, Bree. How are you?
Hello. Good.
Nice to meet you. Nice to see you. I love your outfits.
Now, Bree, where are you from?
I'm from Texas.
Oh. What part of Texas?
Like the Dallas area.
Really? No. So tell us how you got to the DMV.
Work.
Okay. So are you enjoying the DMV so far?
Yeah, so far so good. So far so good.
Great. Well, you willing to play a game? You willing to jump into something real fast?
Yep.
Okay.
Here is your lyric. This is a hard one. You gotta like know this one. Okay.
Come on.
Imagine me being free, trusting you totally.
Don't get nervous.
Can you do it, like, can you sing to the beat of the song?
Yeah, that go, sing it. Oh, yeah, Coco can sing. She can.
No, not
she
me.
Can sing.
Okay, well, that's not a part of the game, Bree. But, okay, well, okay, imagine me being free, trusting you.
Trust in me.
Oh. Okay. Oh. You better trust yourself, Bree. Okay. Well.
I don't even know if that's correct.
It's not.
It's not.
It's not correct. That's okay, though. That's okay, Bree.
Let's. Was the lyric?
Okay. Can you at least guess what the song title is?
Okay.
Yes.
Imagine me, yeah.
There you go. So there you go.
Thank you. 1 point.
Ding,
ding, ding, ding, ding.
She won. We are so happy to have you here tonight. Maybe you can learn some more lyrics later on. Yes. Okay. Well, thank you for joining us this evening. And enjoy.
Thank you for coming. We really appreciate it. Thank you so much. Okay. All right. So we got one more guest, and then we're hopping right into service. Are you excited?
I'm excited.
I'm super excited. I got one more guest. My boy, Kevin. What's up, man? Come on. What's up, Kevin? How are you, bro?
I'm great. How are you? I'm good. How are you?
Man, I'm doing well. I'm happy to be here. So, Kevin, this your what? Have you been to CAYA before?
No, my first time.
Okay. It's your first time. We've had three first-timers. And we just put you on the spot, you know? Okay. So listen, we're going to play a quick game, and then we're going to hop right into service.
Okay. Okay, this is your lyric. I never knew I could be so happy. I never knew
I'd be so secure.
Okay.
There you go. There you go. Kevin's the first person to get it.
Okay, Kevin.
Thank
Kevin
you so
been
much.
Listening to his Kirk.
So,
okay.
Kev, you're the only person that listened to Kirk, obviously, because the way it's been going. So,
all my life.
Uncle Kirk loves you, obviously.
Yes.
So, yeah, man.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Kevin. I'm glad that you knew the lyrics. I'm glad that you know the Lord.
Yeah.
I hope that you enjoy tonight's service, and I hope that you come back. Because you're
Please.
Always welcome here.
Always here. Always welcome, man. Thank you, man. We appreciate you, Kevin. Thank you so much. Well, guess what? We're about to head right into service. Don't leave. Stay. It's going to be a great time tonight. You think so?
I think so, y'all. Thank you so much for joining us for the pregame, for the pre-show. We can't wait.
Can't wait. We about to get started. Bye.
Come on, put your hands together if you love the Lord. Come on. Come on. If you're happy to still be alive today, come on, put your hands together. Listen, from me to you, thank you so much for coming here tonight to CAYA at Alfred Street Baptist Church. Put your hands together again for that. And those of you that are viewing online, you are here with the best young adult community on this side of heaven, okay? And so we're thankful to have all of you here. Listen, I want to start a little different. Birthdays in the month of October. Come on, stand up. Birthdays, October. Birthdays. Come on. All right, y'all ready? Y'all ready? We're going to sing to our people on the count of three. One, two, three. Come on, sing it like you mean it. Come on. I'm still holding. Y'all quit. I'm still holding. All right. Thank y'all so much. Happy birthday to you all. And listen, I'm excited for tonight. I think tonight's going to be amazing. I really think it's going to be amazing. So guess what? We're going to get right into it. So if you would do me a favor, let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity for spaces of authenticity and integrity. And Lord, we thank you in advance for what's going to happen here on tonight, that perhaps somebody will leave transformed, healed, or maybe experience some sense of a breakthrough. We thank you now. We give you praise in advance. Lord, be with us in this hour. Allow your spirit to be in this place. It is your son's name that we pray. Amen. Would you do me a favor and invite and put your hands together for Sharice Tumlin and the CAYA Praise Team.
Right, praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Well, then let me try this. If you're happy and you know it, say. If you're happy and you know it, say. There you are. I just want to make sure we got some people in the house that's going to come and give God praise. Do me a favor. Rest up on your feet. Come on, everybody. Up, 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 up. You done got some food in your belly already. You had a long work day. Now it's time to burn off all those calories. Come on, Carl, let's go. We're going to give God praise. I want y'all to come down the line with us, picking it up.
You are, oh, oh, Lord, you are, oh, Lord.
Let me see you burn that off a little bit. Have mercy. Hallelujah. Yeah, yeah. Say, you are my daily.
You are my daily bread.
You are.
You are my living well.
Come on.
You are my present now.
You are.
You are.
You are. Say it again.
You are. You are. You are my daily bread.
That's it.
You are my living well.
Hey!
There's no one
Somebody thankful they can call on the name of Jesus? Can you just shout out Jesus wherever you are? Come on, let me hear you say Jesus. Shout out Jesus. Have mercy, Lord. That is the name that's above every name. And there's no other name than the name Jesus. Whoa. I want you to take a moment and worship him right where you are in your space. Call the name of Jesus. He is our healer. Call the name of Jesus. He is our provider. Call the name of Jesus. He is our protector, yeah. Call the name of Jesus. He is our deliverer. Right where you are with your hands lifted high, because whenever you need him, you can call him. No matter where you are, you can call him. No matter how you're feeling, you can call him. And all you need to call is just his name, right here, right here, right here. Just say, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Help me say Jesus. Come on, say it.
Jesus.
Say Jesus.
Jesus.
Right where you are in the midnight hour, call him. him.
Jesus.
He will hear you.
Jesus.
And he will come near you.
Jesus.
Yes, sir. There's nobody else who will hear their voice.
Jesus.
Every day he knows
Jesus.
Just what you need.
Jesus.
And you've got to ask him. Whoa, say Jesus.
Jesus. Where you are. Hallelujah. We bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Listen, here at CAYA, we have our own passing of the peace. We're going to sing this song, and I want you to make sure you go ahead and dap up somebody across the aisles and say hello to someone you don't know. But make sure I see you moving. All right? Hey, here we go.
I wanna say
right here, I wanna say
What is a father? Protector, provider, sustainer, encourager. We all have different definitions. As we grow older, those definitions change.
Be you. Being you is cool. Be yourself. Be a leader.
If you don't listen, you get hurt.
Do our experiences with or without our fathers form or shape the way we father, even the way that we live?
Yo, get up and go to school. You ain't gonna get straight A's, but you are gonna get perfect attendance.
All right, I tell my kids all the time, I ask them to get me Dr. Peppers, and I tell them that as a result, I'm gonna dance at their wedding. So that is exactly what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna dance at their wedding, and hopefully there'll be endless Dr. Pepper so the old man can be happy. Yeah.
Tonight, I'm bringing four fathers in that are gonna share their stories and help anchor our conversation. Kaya, let's meet our fathers.
Would y'all do me a favor and give a round of applause for our fathers as they come up? Let's pray before we begin. Lord, we thank you. You are the ultimate Father. Lord, thank you for being our sustainer. Thank you for the gift of life. Lord, thank you for the ongoing work that you continue to do in and through us. We pray tonight, Lord, that the journey or this conversation will be beneficial to somebody. If you would saturate this spirit and allow it to go forth where somebody will be helped. And we'll be sure to give you all praise, glory, and honor. Your son's name, we pray. Amen. So listen, I am so excited for tonight, because I asked these four men to be a part of this conversation. We originally had something else planned for CAYA for the month of October, but after witnessing and seeing Kirk Franklin's documentary, I said, man, I feel like this would be a great opportunity and a great discussion for us to have in CAYA. And so I hope that you'll be blessed tonight. I believe you will be blessed tonight. And so our first guest here tonight is the senior pastor of the historic Alfred Street Baptist Church and the creator and founder of CAYA as well, the Reverend Dr. Howard John Wesley. Come on. Yeah. And this is, I think this pastor's third time coming back this year, second or third time. So y'all, we welcome him back to the house he built. So thank you for coming tonight. We also have Gerald Holden. Come on, give God praise.
Hey, everybody.
Then, listen, when we were coming up with this idea, I remember he sang with his son on one Sunday morning, and I could not figure out his information, but Decius is here with us as well tonight.
Praise the Lord. Good evening, everybody.
And then my good brother that is always at CAYA every single Wednesday, Marcus Moore. Come on, give God praise for him as well. Let's get right into our first clip.
I buried the man I thought was my father. I flew to Houston and made peace with him. But in 2017, I got an anonymous phone call that he was dying of cancer. His name's Dwight. I said to him, I said, you know, I'm told that I'm the biggest selling gospel artist in history. I'm told that I've done this, the first of this, the first of that, that I've won more this than that, more than that. But because I did not have you to tell me who I was, I have always been the most insecure man in the room.
I want to build this conversation around a series of quotes from the documentary. And you heard Kirk just say, Because I didn't have you to tell me who I was, I've always been the most insecure man in the room. And I want to throw this to our panel tonight. Number one, the emphasis on the word insecure. You don't hear men particularly speaking about insecurities. And I want to raise the question, how has your father played a role in building your confidence, and how does it inform your parenting today? Anybody? Y'all just jump right in. Go ahead.
I can answer that question. I can answer that question by putting it in perspective and both answering the question. One thing that really stood out to me, what I look back on, was when I was in high school. I went to a pretty prestigious high school, and I was having a hard time in high school, a real hard time. And I remember hearing my father say one day to my mom, he was like, you know, I really don't think he can make it there. And that right there really, it stick with me to this day. And I remember every time going to school, just thinking like, you know, I can't compete with these kids, you know, them kids, they. And just what I heard Kirk Franklin said, you know, he was told that he was a Grammy Award winning artist. He was told all of these accolades by different people, but he needed to hear it from his father. And so I go back just to say, you know, had I heard that from him, or had I heard some positivity, some affirmations from him, you know, I would have just been invincible. But, you know, fast forward 2022, you know, I got this really cushy government job. I'm making pretty good money. And I started a business like 2 years before I left. And he told me, he said, you know, if you feel like that's the right thing to do, do it. And I felt invincible, you know, when he told me that. I felt like I couldn't be touched. And I just knew I could do anything with God and with his blessings. And so just how does that affect my parenting today? You know, I subconsciously want to criticize my son. And I really struggle with that. But I have to consciously tell myself, you know, give him affirmations, love on him, look at him. You know, he out there playing football. When he make a good play, he look right over at me. I mean, my wife, she's the best. But he look over at me, he give me a nod, even if she's right there. So, yeah, it's crucial. It's a real thing. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for that, Marcus. I can relate to, you know, some of what you said. I had an awesome father. My dad was great. He was very instrumental in my life. He was also a man of few words, right? So what I remember most about my dad was just his model, what he modeled for me, the way he modeled character and the way he modeled integrity. But because he was a man of few words, I can also relate to sometimes feeling like the most insecure person in the room, especially as a boy and as a young man. I can remember times of feeling those insecurities, and I think that as fathers, we have to understand that sometimes those very much needed verbal affirmations need to be present. Your presence is one thing, your model is one thing, the example that we set is one thing, but those verbal affirmations, when you tie all of those things together, I think we set our children up for the greatest success possible. So with my parenting today, oh my goodness, I affirm my son so much. It's crazy. I mean, I tell him I'm proud of him before he even produces the product. And the reason I do that is because he doesn't need to feel like he needs to impress me or impress anybody. Son, I love you already. I'm already proud of you. I've seen you practice. Before you pick up the microphone, I don't care if you hit a wrong note. I don't care if you miss the soccer ball when you kick it. I've seen the work you've put in up to this point. So I'm already proud of you. So I just want to set him up to walk into any space and fill that room with confidence as opposed to filling the room with his insecurities.
I think those are beautiful expressions. And when I saw the video, it hit a little closer home to me because it was literally my story being told to me by someone else. And I'm talking like verbatim. And so I struggle with a lot of things, and I think insecurity is one of them, but in certain circles. There is a void, I think, that was created in my life by not knowing my father. And the backstory is I was 33 years old when I found out that the man that I thought was my biological father was in fact not my biological father. And it happened through a random conversation with my mom. I was pregnant with Gavin, and I was like, oh, we're so excited about this baby. This is gonna be phenomenal. Like, how did you feel when you found out you were pregnant with me? And I was like, and what about dad? And I was like, because he is my dad, right? And I don't know where the question came from. I don't know what prompted me to ask her that. And she said to me, well. And when she said well, I knew that there was something that she hadn't told me. And it's a long, drawn-out journey. I'm still on that journey. I'm 15 years in of finding out that the man that I thought was my father was not. And so that leaves me insecure in lots of places, but I've been able to manage, but I still long to know who I am in that experience.
Tough question. I feel very privileged to have had a dad that was involved in everything. And, you know, what Kirk said is a reminder that no matter what you achieve in life, all of us desire, especially as men, to hear our father say, I'm proud of you. That no matter what you put on the shelf, we long for that. And it was once said to me that the only person, the only man who's happy to see another man surpass him is his father. Right? And I was raised by a dad like that. And I say this with a lot of confidence and prayerfully not an ounce of conceit, but I've never been insecure in any room in my life because my father raised me early and put me in privileged places and shared with me, you belong there. And the way you prove you belong there is that you outdo everyone, right? So in every room, you take the lead and you have no reason to be insecure. My dad had these slogans like, second place is just the first loser. Right? You have to win. If you get 100, you don't have to worry about a curve because 100 is an A all the time. And I realized that part of the reason my dad pushed me like that, I didn't know his backstory. And come to find out that my father was a product of an affair with a preacher who came to town and had an affair with my grandmother. And so all of my aunts and uncles are last name Nicholas and Williams. We're the only Wesley from that 12 because she decided I'm gonna name you after the preacher that got me pregnant. And so my dad always walked with an insecurity because he knew and everyone knew that he was an illegitimate child by a preacher. And that stained him. And I think he lived his life trying to prove to people he was worthy. And the way he proved it was by succeeding and by earning more and then pushing that into us as his children, that whatever room you walk in, you deserve to be here and prove it to everyone else. For good and for bad, that's helped me in ways, but it's also hurt me. So as I raise my sons, I have to fight telling them you gotta win everything. That you've got to be at the top because you're always worthy when you're at the top. And trying to accept that that's not everybody's way. Everyone doesn't have that kind of killer mindset, but I want them to be secure. So I fight a lot of what my father put in me so that I don't harm my sons thinking everything's a competition.
Let's give it up for them. I won't. I want to go back to something that Gerald said. So Gerald and I also were part of a conversation the other day when recording. I would really like for you to expound on the line that you said that I was still stuck when I was thinking about today. that wasn't caught on camera, in your pursuit of your of trying to figure out your biological father, you made a statement pertaining to your mother. You said you realize that your truth is her trauma.
First of all, let me just say for the record, I love and adore my mother. And if you know me, you know that my mother is also a woman. She is a woman who had to make choices in her life. And so I don't, as a son, sit in judgment of her. I seek to understand. So I realized early on that what I was dealing with was a traumatic experience for her, and that it's difficult for her to give me the truth that I need if she was not willing to do her own work. But I still give her the grace and the time to do her work, because I think the truth is the freedom that both of us will benefit from. And so I'm not trying to press her or push her. I simply ask the questions that I need to ask to get the understanding. And then there are other ways that I can approach the situation. So if she, and I think she's gotten to the end of her answers for me, so now there are other opportunities that I can take. I just don't want my story to be told to me from somebody else. I think that's probably the part that I struggle with the most. And it's so random, because I'm from a small town, and you grow up and there are these rumors, and you know, there's all these innuendos, but you never know for certain, because nobody is willing to do the work of getting to the truth. And I could approach it a number of different ways and dig down and drill and get information and piece things together, but I'm concerned about her. And so I give her the grace and the space, and I had a long conversation with her today about it, because I was trying to figure out, like, I wanted her to know that I was trying to exploit her, I wasn't trying to put her business out, but we are tied together very closely in this, and that I still deserve to be able to speak my truth and my experience. And that whatever reflection that is on her, I'll let her do her work with that. So I'm grateful, but I love her, and I really hope that this just propels her to be transparent so she can get the healing that she needs, and that I can be healed as well.
Thank you. Thank you. Come on, give it up for Let's jump right into our next clip as well. Let's go right into the next clip.
Give me a chance. This is gonna be a lot, but I wanna hug you. Please forgive me if it's not the best hug.
Nah, bro.
Just
he didn't even know. He didn't even know he had a son.
So if you know that scene from the documentary, it's when Kirk and his father both realize, well, his father then realizes that Kirk is his son. And before he hugs him, he says, this may not be the best hug. And I just want to just throw that out there and just get reaction and thoughts, just open floor to that scene, into that statement. Just, this may not be the best hug, but I'm going to hug you.
I'll start off speaking to this because I'm very affectionate with my son. I hug my son every day. I kiss my son. Every day. And sometimes I hug him, and just being 9 years old, he doesn't hug me back all the way. And I know that there's gonna come a time where he doesn't really want the hug at all, but I want him to feel what a real, loving, genuine hug feels like. And when we experience those moments of, hey, you didn't hug me all the way back, I say, hug me again. Because I want him to really know and feel what a real hug, a loving hug, feels like.
You know, it's tough. This is, my sons are at that space. I've got the 19 and 16, and I get the, you're right, Dad, I catch you, you know? And I long for the hugs. I look at pictures of lifting them up, and Cooper grabbing my neck and, you know, miss those days. And it's even tougher because I see the way they interact with their mother. And they hug their mother immediately. You know, a game is over, I get the head nod, mom gets the hug, and I get angry. Like, boy, if you ever make it in basketball and you get on TV and you call out your mama before me, it's gonna be a problem. It's gonna be a real problem. But there's another form of affection that has grown between us. I remember the very first time I told my dad I love him. You would have thought I told him I was going to jail. The look on his face, like he had no idea how to respond to me saying, I love you. And eventually he grew into it, and we said it all the time. So now, for me, the affection is that my boys never get off the phone without saying, I love you. We never end a text without saying, I love you. And I think breaking down not only the physical, but being able to express that I love you in a way that is not sexual, that is not anything to use anyone, it's not trying to gain, has been the best affection I feel for my kids, that we always say, I love you.
For me, my kids are funny. And we are affectionate at home all the time. Now in public, it's a different story because, you know, the teenagers. But we always call it, I'm going down, are you going up? Because nobody wants to go up on the hug, so I call it down on the inside. And I challenged them about bristling all the time. But one of the things that I decided to do in my own life and how I parent them was to challenge the norms of what I experienced about how I engage my children. And it's like, that was a touch from his father. And he said, I don't know what I can do, but I'm gonna bring myself. And for me, with my kids, it's just kind of like, I'm going to just give it all to you. Like, I personally never experienced that, so I don't know what that's like. So creating a space for them that is unforgettable, I teeter with the perfection thing because sometimes I think I have to be perfect, but I realized that all I needed to be for them was just present. And that was sufficient enough. So even if I don't get it right, if I just stay there, it's an opportunity to have a conversation about something that impacts us and not shy away from all of the things. And I think that's where the emotional connection comes from. My kids know I'm random. I'll throw out a topic and we'll talk about sex. What you want to do? Because I would much rather them be a little awkward around me than find themselves in a position where they have not walked into a level of truth so that they can make the best decisions for themselves.
That piece with Kirk Frank. First, I'll say, yeah, you know, I can definitely agree with all of the gentlemen here. Like, I know it's going to be a day where, you know, my son, he's not going to want my hugs, so I try to get them all in right now. I'm always kissing on him and stuff like that. But that scene really hit me because up until recently, from a mentor of mine, I never hugged a male like that, ever. Ever. And the only male is my son that I've ever hugged like that. And so seeing Kurt like struggle to hug him, and when my mentor hugged me that same way, it was a struggle for me because it was weird, like non-sexual or anything like that. But when I did it, just like Kurt, I felt like the healing. I felt like my 5-year-old self, my 10-year-old self, like getting a hug from his father. And I had I can never recall experiencing that.
Thank you. Let's go right into this next one. This was probably one of my favorite lines of the documentary.
Love is a muscle that has to be trained. And if it's never been trained, just because you get introduced to it doesn't know you know how to receive it. Is I think that you become indoctrinated in trauma, that you become institutionalized in your trauma, in some sick, warped, broken way, you wonder,
Who am I? Well, because I've only known me broken.
Kirk said, who am I? Well, because I've only known me broken. I think he's drawing a line or a connection between, you know, knowing his father and his sense of identity. And I guess it almost in a sense is to some degree in relationship to the first question that we posed tonight. But in how does knowing and not knowing your father play a role into your identity, like as of right now, as of today?
Man, there's no way for me. I carry his name. I carry the shoes. I preach. I do what my dad did. It influences me in ways I still am learning. I think the positive role of my father, because he tried to keep us well as much as possible. I realize I am blessed. My dad was never not there. The biggest influence from my dad was teaching me how to recover from being broken. Mom kisses the bruises and the hugs. Dad knew when the man was being formed and was being shaped by that. And that was breaking moments when he taught me how to respond like a man, how to live through it and not become traumatized or hurt other people through it. He was there for those moments. I remember the first time I ever encountered, you know, the real ill effects of being black in a white campus. And my father was there, and he pulled me to the side, and he talked to me, and we walked through what was really hurting me, and he could see it. He gave me permission to cry. He gave me permission, but not in the presence of others. He said, we're gonna cry, but not in front of all these white folk, right? We're gonna go in the back, we're gonna cry, and we're gonna come out and show them who you are. So for me, I love the idea of being there for my sons to help them see you're not always going to be well. Breaking is inevitable, and here's how we learn to heal through the truth of the trauma, how we work through that, because you got to get back on your feet. And I think that was one of the greatest gifts my dad helped me see, that it's okay not to be well, but how do you get back?
Yeah. I think there's just the obvious void for me. So I'm not certain what that experience is supposed to feel like. Right. So for me, with my children, I try to be maybe the father that I didn't have. Right. So I don't know. And again, it's twofold for me, because I think that while I long to know who he is, I don't know if it's the hand of God holding back something that I just didn't need to experience. Or if I was being denied this idea of what I thought my life should be. And I think what I've transitioned to doing is learning how to live the life I have as opposed to the life I think I was supposed to have. And so that has informed how I relate to my children by, again, being present. And I think for a father, it is just, it's in the mundane. People look at the big things where you think of, well, Father's Day and all these other things, which we really don't get celebrated, do I? But it's the chance passing in the hallway when you ask your son if he brushed his teeth and you find out that his day wasn't so good. And you can really have a conversation. So it's about availing yourself. And so I'm finding now that I'm present in ways that I wish someone had been present for me, but I still get to do that in their life. And so I'm grateful for that.
No, that's real powerful. The positive sides that I can definitely see from my father, he was definitely there, but just like Decia said, my father, he was just a man of very, very little words. He was there, he provided, and that's one thing I'm just like so huge on with my family. I gotta make sure that they're taken care of first before I eat or before anything happens. I just gotta make sure that they're good. But I think Pastor Wesley, he said it in the intro, you know, you might not make all A's, but, you know, you're going to have perfect attendance. And it's power in showing up. It really is. And so that's one thing that I really try to give my son every day, just show up and just be there for him, just have an open ear.
So I talked about my dad being a man of few words, right? But I also talked about his model and his example. And what I didn't mention is how present he was. Man, my dad was present. He was there. He didn't miss games. He was always in the stands. Deep. You know, there were those silent affirmations from time to time, right? But he was there. But when I think about his model and his example, Pastor Wesley, my dad was a United Methodist pastor. And he pastored and he taught high school math. So his commitment, not only to his family, but his commitment to Christ, his commitment to church, his commitment to pastoring, his commitment to people, are all things that I hold on to even today. His love for people, the love that he showed people, his relationships, the way he valued those things with people, those are all things that I brought with me into adulthood. The unfortunate thing is sometimes we don't see those things in middle school, right? We just want to do our own thing and be ourselves, right? But as I became a man and a father, I only wished I could be half the dad that my dad was. Because I recognized how great he was at it.
Thank you, thank you. Let's hop right into the next clip.
I would say to my 24-year-old self that what you do is not who you are, and your identity was never to be in your gift.
In that clip, Kirk said, I would say to my 24-year-old self that what you do is not who you are, and your identity was never to be in your gift. I think, and I just want to throw this one out again to just get various responses. I think as men, there is this tendency that we do tend to equate our identity to what we can do. We do things to try to accomplish things because we unconsciously, and maybe even consciously, tie our identities into what we do. And Kirk says he wished he could say that to his 24-year-old self, that your identity was never to be in your gift. And everybody at this on this panel, they're gifted individuals. I just want to hear your response to that. The fact that I'm not my identity. I'm not my gift. My gift is what God has given to me and me to be a good steward over it, but I'm not my gift.
I felt like a lot of my teenage years, adult years, were performative. Like I had to do and be for everybody else. I'm from a large family, and the one thing you want to do is not stand out. You don't want to be ostracized. You don't want to be picked on. So you shut up in color. And that's exactly what I did. Like, I never questioned anything. I never, until I got to a place where I saw other people living differently and having different experiences, I never knew that that was possible for me. Mm-hmm. Like, that's how small my world was. And it was only through God's provision and the United States military that really took me from a place and planted me somewhere else. And then I was able to see a world that didn't open up for me at home. And the one thing I knew for sure was that I had to leave. And I did. And my one prayer to God was like, I just don't want to go back. I love my family. I knew that that wasn't a safe space for me. And when we talk about fathers, one of the things I think we don't talk about is the power of a father to create a safe space for his children to be. Not to do, but to be. To be a kid. And the one thing that I want for my children in all of their experience is to have a childhood and not worry about adult themes. So I'm trying to do my work so I don't bleed on them and they don't have to come and sit on a couch and talk about a father who wasn't there for them the way that he thought he was.
I think it's important to share a little bit of disagreement with Kirk's statement. I don't think we are what we do, but eventually what we do shapes who we become. And one of the things I had to learn the hard way, and I don't know if a father could have taught me, was that your decisions and compiled errors will ultimately affect who you become as a man. And you can't escape that. My dad had a saying that I tended to forget in my middle 20s, but I remember now. He said, as a man, you're gonna have to make tough decisions. And what's gonna make you a man is to have the wisdom to weigh out and then be man enough to live with the consequences of your choice. Mm-hmm. And so often, I fail to weigh and I want to run from the consequence, not recognizing that that life hurts other people. And if I could go back and talk to my 20-year-old self, it would be a lesson of not using and hurting people on your way, using your gift, and thinking that that gift justified where you landed. You know, and you leave people in the wake of, they paid the consequence for your gift and your elevation. And then you reach a place where the gift takes you and you're numb to hurting other people because it's just your way of living. And I wish I had known that more.
This is a good question, right? But to my 24-year-old self, I was already saved and maybe I wasn't following Christ as I should have been. But knowing what I know now, like my identity is directly connected to who I am in Christ. My character, my integrity, those things. And those are the things that people see. That's what my son is going to see. And that's ultimately also going to shape his thinking and his beliefs and who he becomes. So my answer to this question is really short. To my 24-year-old self, I would have been a lot more serious about the things of God. I would have been a lot more serious about purpose because those are the things that I believe are connected to our identity.
Absolutely. And right along the same lines as Decius, if what I would tell my 24-year-old self right now is, you know, time, you don't get it back. It ain't coming the second time around. So make good use of that time. Just by God's grace, you know, I was always guided by pretty decent people outside of my household. And granted, I had a pretty solid household, but I looked to other males in my life. And just, again, by God's grace, they guided me the right way. But after having that guidance and after making the decision to, you know, go into a career, just take advantage of opportunities and not waste as much time.
So I want to pivot also. I want to build piggyback off that question. So we heard what you would say to your 24-year-old self. If tonight you could have a vulnerable, open conversation with your father today, what would you say?
What your name is? I mean, who are you? No, honestly, let me tell you how crazy I am. Like, I still reserve a space for him. I still have room in my heart for him. And I really hope, if he's alive, and I hope that he has or space for a memory or his story. Like, I'm very curious about what his journey was like. And I reserve the right to hold a space for that, to honor him in that way. Because there is no way, the experience that I'm having as a father, if this dude knew he could have that kind of experience with me, I know he would not have done it intentionally. No way. No way. So I would like to think that maybe he just didn't know. I don't know. And again, that we can get on that whole conversation about how the father didn't know that that was his son, and the lady is a small town and she's pregnant and you were with her. You knew her biblically. How did you now not look back and think? And I think as a man, you're thinking about where you've been and what you've done and not have the courage to look back and make sure you didn't leave anything behind. That's a different kind of negligence for me. And so that's what I just hope that men are mindful of the decisions and the actions that they take, and they're not so cavalier that they just forget it. That's a spot. I don't, and so I worry if that's his mentality, like maybe that's what God protected me from, because I know I wouldn't do well with that.
So I lost my dad in 2018. But if I could have a conversation with him now, I would say thank you. Just thank you, because I realize now how much he really did. I realize how much he did and the effort that had to go into everything that he did. And I'm like, if the things that he did is, if that's supposed to be the floor, like I'm in the basement right now, right? Like I've got some growing to do. I've got some maturing to do. So I would say thank you just for giving me a blueprint to follow, for giving me things that I could pull from and make my own, and like and make this thing called parenting and fatherhood work. Because without that, I don't know. So Gerald, I can't even begin to explain like how my experience would be different right now had I not had a dad and had he not been so present. So I mean, it's just thank you. And just forgetting about all of the insecurities that I had, but understanding now that like you really did your thing. Thank you.
The conversation I would have, I would honestly apologize just for, I guess, thinking so righteous of myself after being a father for 5 years right now and about to be another one next month. Because, you know, it's no handbook, it's no rules, it's no... You know, let me show you how to do this. And to be honest, he may have just been doing the best he could. And I just got to take that. And you know, I would apologize.
I think I'd offer an apology too. I watched my dad die a very slow death of cancer, and at the time, I didn't really have the emotional tools to process and deal with losing him. And I processed it by being angry. Angry that he was dying, that he was leaving me. And as I allowed myself to get wrapped up in what I thought was the success of pastoring in Massachusetts to justify staying away from his sickness, because I didn't want to see it. And the price I paid was that I got a phone call telling me he died. And I would just apologize for not being there while he was dying, because I didn't know how to handle it and I was afraid. And I hope when I see him, that he knows I would do that all differently.
Thank you. Let's jump right into the clip, the next clip.
Calling the album Father's Day.
Ooh.
And the long run is what I missed, where I am, and what's always been.
What I missed, where I am, what's always been. In light of our conversation, what we're having right now, just if you all had to take that those three statements and expound upon them, where will you land? Where would you come up with? What I missed, where I am, what's always been?
What I missed? A father. Where I am is present. Like, I'm not living in spaces that don't exist with him. And what's always been is what will always be. And that is, I know that God loves me. And I'm foolish enough to believe that the story's messed up right now for me, like, because I have no personal resolve. But I know that that is not the end of my story. And so I comfort myself by knowing that it will be revealed when it's supposed to, and I'm not antsy about that revelation. I know that there is something that I need to do, though. So that's my offering, is to do my part, and whatever God chooses to do with my story and my situation, I'm confident that it will be beautiful for him and for me.
Yeah, that's a good one. What I miss, I frequently think about, you know, if I had, you know, that type of confidence, those type of affirmations, but at the same time, I know, just like I know the sun is gonna come up in the morning, I know that I'm gonna be restored 110% of everything, that anything that I may have missed. And what I am right now, I'm so far from where I was. Just being a better person, a better father, and just doing it every day. And I think just what has always been is this school of humanity, this school of fatherhood, and just learning every single day. And me not believing that I'm, you know, I'm a better father than my father, you know, he just didn't know. So he's learning, I'm learning, we all learning.
I don't know what I missed. My dad and my parents gave me a blessed life, and I'm grateful for it. I don't look at anyone else's life and envy a relationship or material possessions, because my parents were so good to me. So I don't know what I missed. Where I am, it's same with you, being present with my kids, because I realize that's the best legacy I can give them, is the memories and the time, and, you know, to know that they long for cooking in the kitchen with me or taking our father-son trip. They hate Father Fridays, which is when we have to sit down and talk about life. They hate that, but they enjoy pretty much everything else because I try to be present for them. And what's always been there, hopefully, is what I've received in the past to them, that there's always mercy to be forgiven and grace to try again. And forgive yourself and try again, even when others won't offer you that forgiveness. If you receive it yourself from the Lord, accept God's grace to try again.
What I missed, opportunities to learn. I didn't talk to my dad enough. And I know in my heart that he had a wealth of knowledge and many, many things that he could teach me. But there were so many things that I kept bottled up. There were things that I didn't want to discuss. There were times that I chose to speak to my brother, my big brother, as opposed to speaking to dad. And I missed his perspective on a lot of things. Where I am now is growth and a desire each and every day to just strengthen my relationship with Christ. Because what's always been has been God and Christ in my life, and loving me and supporting me and showering me with love. That's what's always been.
Thank you. Next clip, please. Next clip.
My father gave me a privileged and blessed beginning. of my life. And everything I've achieved or seek to achieve, I owe in no small part to that man right there. Earl, the shoes I wear today are the shoes my father died in. And I wear them to remind me that every time I preach, I literally stand in his shoes. I can't recall a single moment of my life when my father wasn't there.
So I think it was actually crazy to me when I was sitting in church Sunday, listening to the sermon, because obviously I knew that this was going to be our topic for CAYA, and you know that this wasn't like pre-planned, right? It was a pivot, and then Pastor Wesley preached this sermon entitled "Rest in Peace," and he gave that illustration, not even illustration, like a very vivid lived experience of being in his father's shoes. And Pastor, I really just want to throw this to you. I don't even know what I want to hear from it. But I don't know. I could not get that image out of my mind for the entirety of the day. That there's a reality that we are always standing in, at minimum, somebody's shoes. And the implications of such, I found myself wrestling with. I don't know. I just would love to hear you. I don't even know what I want to hear, but just something, if you have.
My brothers followed my dad in his business. I'm the only one that followed him in ministry. And as a young preacher, I was called in 1989, before many of y'all were born.
That's true. 92.
Yeah. I preached my first sermon in 1989, and literally every opportunity that I received to preach was because someone was extending a favor to my dad. And those privileges gave me exposure as a young preacher. So by the time I went to college in 1990, I had already preached 100 times. Opportunities kept coming, it kept coming. And I was able to grow as a preacher long before I went to seminary because my dad had opened up so many doors for me. And it's weird to hear people tell you what you're gonna be because of who your dad was. Oh, you're gonna be a preacher. If you ever, like, I hate it when people do that to my sons. Like, which one of them is gonna preach? Hopefully neither one of them, because this sucks, right? This is not all it's cracked up to
Thank
be.
You, Pastor.
Yeah. But literally, those shoes were the ones he died in. So they're 16 years old. And I have them resoled and polished every year so that I can keep wearing them. It's my way of connecting to my dad. It's my way of hoping he's still proud of me and honoring him. Yeah, man, it's tough. That I'm just grateful.
Thank you. Just clap it up, Pastor. And then just to end it, to the rest of our panel, if you just, any type of response to that, or just anything, your thoughts, how it resonated with you, yeah.
I watched my dad for years stay up at night writing sermons. I authored a book
a little over a year ago titled Young Man, We Gotta Make It to Heaven. And I felt that some of those long nights that I stayed up writing, I felt the connection. In each chapter, as I felt like I was writing many sermons. When I think about standing in his shoes, I'm not a preacher, but I'm a preacher. Because I minister to young men, I minister to people every chance that I get. And I just think about the job that my father did in doing that every day of his life and how committed he had to be to it. I'm grateful for having that experience. I'm grateful for not literally being able to stand in his shoes, but I'm grateful to be able to help lead others to Christ. I'm grateful that I was shown that by my father.
I obviously don't have any shoes to stand in, but I got feet. And I'm grateful for the fact that when I joined the military, again, the world opened up for me and I got to see different people doing different things. And I have a ton of fantastic mentors who are awesome fathers. And so to not even know that that was a desire or something that I would actually be one day, it was really nice to be close to people to see how they related to their children. So it was a different experience for me. It was external to me, like, oh, okay, well, that's how you do that. And then my older sister and I often have this conversation about, like, where do you go to learn how to parent if you've never been a parent before? And so a lot of the grace that I think I give, or I've given to my mom in that experience, is that, you know, when you know better, you do better. And I feel like we're just living in a different age where parenting is, it's a little different. And it's more of a hands-on approach than a hands-off approach. I think a lot of us at a certain age were raised on autopilot, you know, street lights, all those things. And in the country, nobody really checking for you. So I'm grateful that I've had mentors along the way to demonstrate in the front of me and to provide stellar examples of fatherhood and excellence in a way that was tangible for me that I could apply into my own life.
Amen. I think what I'm most grateful for is, of course, you know, the mentors and, you know, my parents and just me being able to have all of them. But I think what I'm most grateful for is just having the opportunity to do it. And when I say that, what I mean by that is, you know, growing up in D.C. in the late 90s, throughout the early 2000s, going to high school, it was a lot going on. A lot of my friends, you know, were killed due to gun violence, and I seen a lot. So just seeing that and being just able to do it, just being present to do it, that's what I'm most grateful for.
Kaya, y'all do me a favor, and let's give a round of applause to our panelists here today.
Thank you all.
Thank you for your vulnerability. Thank you for accepting. You did not have to, and I thoroughly appreciate it. And I think somebody was indeed helped tonight. So thank you, gentlemen, so much. We really appreciate it. One more time, let's give it up for them. So tonight we're coming to an end. Thank you all so much again for coming again to CAYA in October. This is our 10th. No, what number is this? What number, CAYA, is this? It's eighth. It's our eighth one. So listen, we have two more. Our next CAYA is in November. All my first time CAYA people, raise your hand. First time ever coming to CAYA. Listen, thank y'all. Thank you so much for being a part. We truly appreciate it. And listen, if you want to join and be a part of Alfred Street Baptist Church, you can email us at deacons with an S, at alfredstreet.com. CAYA.org to be a member of this body of Christ. Pastor Wesley would love to be your pastor, and the person on the right or left of you would love to be your brother or your sister. All those that participated in the pregame downstairs, raise your hand. Thank you all so much for participating. We truly put your hands together for them again. And we're all standing all over the room. Thank you all so much. Grab somebody by the hand. If you don't mind, you don't have to if you don't feel like it. Some of y'all may not have washed your hands. If you will receive this blessing, now the love of God, the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the sweet communion of His Holy Spirit, may it rest, rule, and abide with us now and forevermore. And for all those that love Jesus, shout amen. And I'll see you in November. See y'all later. I'm headed to the pre-show, the post-show. Come on, come on, come on. I'm headed to the post show.
Amazing. That was a lot, man, to be transparent and vulnerable, because that was some heavy stuff, man. And talking about your dad isn't that easy. And so we got a guest we bringing on right now. Come on. What's up, Damien? How are you?
All right. I'm doing well.
Now, Damien, is this your first time?
Yes, it is.
Damien is another first time. We've had all first timers tonight. So, Damien, tell me what you thought about tonight.
It was inspiring. I think everybody had different experiences with their parents, particularly fathers. Myself being a male, so I think it just gave me perspective. It also let me know that I wasn't the only one that might have experienced what I experienced. Mm-hmm. So it was just good to hear somebody else's story.
Gotcha. So, Damien, are you a father?
I am not a father.
Not a father. Okay, so, but still, even with you not being a father, you felt tonight was helpful to some degree.
100%.
Man, thank you so much, Damien. That means the world to us. And, man, hopefully you'll come back. Is this
hopefully
your first time, man?
Yes.
We really appreciate it. And we're here every first Wednesday. So thank you for coming, man.
All right.
We really appreciate it.
Thank you, man.
Thank you. Pleasure to meet you as well.
Likewise.
Absolutely.
All right.
So, yeah, that's one. We have another brother coming up. What's up, man?
How you doing? Awesome job.
Thank you. Give me your name.
Justin.
Where are you from?
I am originally from Martinsville, Virginia.
Oh, Martinsville, Virginia. Okay, so is this your first CAYA?
Second CAYA, actually.
When was your first one?
First one was last month.
Really? Okay, so yeah. Thank you for coming again,
of course.
We really appreciate it. Give us some thoughts about tonight. What you think?
So, I'm not a father myself, but as an aspiring father, hopefully, you know, when that time is right, this was awesome.
Yeah.
You know, just hearing the different perspectives, you know, from everyone, having fathers that were present, you know, having fathers that, you know, they're not aware of, you know, haven't met, it was extremely powerful. So, you know, I think the message that I took away, it helped me form, and you know, not only as a man, but as a potential father down the road, it was really powerful for me. I took a lot of lessons just as a man. So this was really, really powerful.
Well, man, thank you so much. It means the world that you came back for a second time. Hopefully we see you for a third time. And thank you for being a part tonight, man. And thank you. That's all I can say.
Yeah, and an incredible job to yourself, by the way.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you, bro.
Look forward to seeing you next month.
Thank you, man. Absolutely. So, there y'all have it. Listen, thank you all for tuning in. You know, we're always going to be here every first Wednesday. And Alfred Street Baptist Church, CAYA, is where you belong. This is your community. So, yeah, I'll see y'all next time. Love you.
come ready to be used. He was beaten and bruised for the remission of your sins. So come as you are and let new life begin.
Well, Pastor Wesley is the truth. He spits the gospel fire. So come, praise the Lord, grow your faith. Welcome to CAYA.
Come, come tormented, battered, and abused, but the Lord says, so come ready to be used. He was beaten and bruised for the remission of your sins, so come as you are and let new life begin.
Well, Pastor Wesley is the truth. He spits the gospel fire, so come, praise the Lord, grow your faith, welcome to CAYA.